Conscious Awareness Meditation Practice, Part 2. In Part 1, we covered some of the reasons why reprogramming our thoughts and maintaining presence is beneficial. Continuing in this manner, we go on. Focus on what you're doing to the exclusion of all else and accomplish whatever task is at hand to the best of your ability. The inner nagging, complaining voice will gradually shut off. Mental quiet bringing with it inner peace and clarity will begin to emerge. And as you change the pattern of your inner world, thought awareness, the outer will alter as well. For example, I have had many jobs in my life. At one time, I was a dealer in a casino. For those who don't know it, a casino is a filthy, dirty place, and I don't mean physically. It is full of miserable, angry addicts constantly doing the same thing and expecting a different result, which is the definition of insanity. And you, as the dealer, are trapped with all these crazy people at your table for hours with them. Some of them stay for days. They are there when you leave, there wearing the same clothing because they never went home when you return the following night. It's a real sickness. This is not a positive atmosphere in which to work. It's extremely abusive. You get nonstop abuse from players and in many cases from the pit boss as well, whose word is as good as God's. You cannot speak in your own defense. You're expected to suck it up and keep your mouth shut, keep smiling, and deal the cards. There was a movie where this family goes to Vegas and the father gets on a blackjack table with the quintessential dealer from hell. That scene made me laugh my ass off because it's actually so true. I know lots of dealers who would have given a lot to be able to act that way just once. Oh. But anyhow, when these addicts don't get the result they want, they hate the dealer's guts because she is taking their money, which is their job, and it's not personal, at least not at first. What players don't understand is that the odds in any table game or the slots are calculated to a nicety by the ones who designed the games. The house always wins. For every $1,000 a table takes in, the odds are designed to pay out $100. I got that tidbit straight from a casino games designer from Vegas. The house keeps the 900, the players get just enough to keep them interested in continuing to play. It is extremely rare that the odds work the other way, though in extremely rare cases I have seen this happen. 99% of the time, though, the house wins. Most players love to blame and hate on the dealers. I remember one guy I particularly disliked for this reason. If you are in a casino, I advise you to be nice to the dealers because I guarantee you that if you aren't, they will secretly be hoping you lose. Because the sooner you lose everything, the sooner you'll go away. My particular problem player would always come to my table and then proceed to blame me for hours on end, asking me, when is your break? Asking me, why are you giving me these shitty cards? Etc. Just an unending stream of verbal diarrhea of negativity directed at me, till I couldn't stand the sight of him. I really hated him. Just seeing him coming made me feel sick and put me in a bad mood. Till one night I decided to not allow his verbal harassment and negativity to affect me. I forced myself to be neutral towards him, even in the innermost secrecy of my thoughts. I consciously stopped myself from hating his guts. The moment I began to think anything hateful at him, I changed it to something neutral. I began to treat him like somebody I was happy to see. At first, this was very hard for me to do, but something truly amazing happened after a few months of this. He began to change in response to this silent meditation I was practicing. He became a completely different man after a few months. Actually quite nice. He stopped verbally harassing me. I was actually happy to see him coming to my table after this instead of feeling sick. It was a very dramatic demonstration of the power of controlling your thoughts and how this manifests a change in the physical world. To further illustrate this point, I will use another example from the casino. I was what players call a very strong dealer, meaning it was extremely difficult to win money from me. Some players, in fact, would gather their chips and take off running when they saw me coming. And so one night at 4 a.m, bored and with 2 extremely likable and generous tipping players who had joined me at my blackjack table, I decided to try an experiment. Normally, I'm all about the business, which is, of course, taking the players' money. That's my job. And as a result, most people couldn't win against me. I was, in fact, considered a cooler. Once the floor manager brought me from my table into the high limit room to kill a game and recoup the money another dealer before me had mistakenly paid out to a player who refused to return the chips, an amount of around $10,000-$20,000. No, not a small mistake. I cleaned him out in 15 minutes. After the player departed, the floor manager came and asked me, "Well, did you kill him?" I said, "Yeah, of course." He told me, "Good job. The casino is in the business of taking your money, not paying you." But anyhow, this night I decided I wanted to see what would happen if I did the opposite, and began visualizing winning hands for the 2 players and myself busting, and guess what? It worked. They literally cleared my tray of chips. I had to have a refill. If I remember correctly, the average on a regular table in chips is around $30,000 to $50,000. That amount is, of course, considerably higher in a high limit room, which is about $200,000. But $30,000 to $50,000 was what my tray that night held, meaning they made minimum, I estimate, $20,000 to $30,000. Security came and replenished my tray. I continued to deal again, willing them to win, and they did. They cleaned my tray out a second time. I had to have an emergency fill, and the next thing I knew, I had the floor manager standing behind me, asking my pit boss, "What the hell's going on here?" And she replied, "I don't know, they keep winning. This is not usual. So of course, security summoned the floor manager, who stood there now watching me deal. And still, these 2 guys were winning, tossing me $50 and $100 chips in tips after each round they won. I was tapped eventually off for my break. They were very sorry to see me go. Reprogramming your mind, controlling what thoughts you allow yourself to focus on, takes work. It's not easy. This will be a battle. At first, your mind is going to be bucking and resisting like a wild animal, but as you counter the negative voices within, you'll find more and more calm and peace in your own head. This is the first of many benefits you will reap from this meditation. The second benefit is that because you are now aware, you are grounded. You won't find yourself reacting to things going on out there in the world around you. You'll find yourself acting on clear, reasoned, pragmatic choices that you make. You cease to be a sheep led around, subconsciously influenced by what you see on TV, read in the papers. You'll cease to listen to, follow anyone mentally stronger than you are who is a bad influence. You'll be able to discern they are a bad influence. Or when, for instance, a certain narrative is being pushed at you from all around, you'll take the time to stop and question if this is really true, to think for yourself, arrive at your own conclusions, and act accordingly. People have been conditioned by the mind matrix that is all around us to give our free will over and follow. Most believe what they're told unquestioningly. If it says so on the TV, it must be true, which of course is not true. People don't realize this is your one life. Yes, we're born again and again, but this present eternal now is all the time you have at any given time. And things can happen in an instant. You can be struck by a car, robbed, raped, all kinds of things. You can, for example, make a bad decision like choosing to stand on a freeway at night wearing black and be struck by a car. One unconsidered action can have great personal consequences. You want to make reasoned, pragmatic decisions that are beneficial for yourself and those around you at all times. An example. Idealistic and misguided, a young person caught up in the emotion of thinking he, she is being a hero fighting for what's right, decides to torch a building, car, or what have you, gets caught and charged. Now their life is effectively over as they face time in a federal prison. These kinds of errors in thought happen to young people in particular because they don't have a lot of life experience, are naive, and haven't really thought out the consequences of their actions. These are just a few examples. There are many. Like, for instance, making the decision to drive while impaired, then accidentally killing other people in the ensuing car accident. Things can happen in an instant, so be aware. Aware of the thoughts you're entertaining, how you might be influenced and led by the nose to be another's useful idiot. This is one level of why it's beneficial to practice conscious awareness meditation. But now we will examine this from a deeper level, understanding that creation, the essential force that underlies reality as we know it, is sensitive to thought. You are an antennae that transmits thoughts and feelings, and this in turn affects the world around you. Thoughts literally become things. Use of mindful awareness leads one to the next logical step: control over your physical conditions in this life. Take mastery over your inner life, that which you call mental, and this leads to mastery over your physical life. You transform your life, self, when you transform how you think. But there's more. Practicing awareness, examining thoughts that enter your head, questioning why you are thinking something non-helpful, and changing it, leads to the enjoyment of a calm rationality, which in turn allows for identification of illogical impulses as they come to you for what they are, non-helpful, and consciously defying them until they stop, they will, thus enabling you to identify personal vulnerabilities of character you can then fix. It's a powerful method of self-help. What the saying, physician, heal thyself, actually means. You become mentally, physically stronger because you're clearing out all kinds of negative junk from your mind and body. This brightens the aura. This cleanliness is reflected in your energy field, meaning people will be drawn to you, much more likely to want to interact with you, respect you, listen to you, work with and or help you because you have good energy, which was the transformation I achieved with my player back when I was a dealer, for example. This is a fundamental tool of mastery as it affects not only our inner world, but also the outer. Even if you aren't aware of it, the truth is we are always wrapped in our own energy field, and other people can sense it. Our emotional thought states are reflected in the aura. I'd attended a business meeting and afterwards was riding my bike home on a fine summer night just past sunset. I was tootling along slowly on the sidewalk, playing tourist, when my intuition told me to get on the road. I listened to it and got on the road. And now I'm coming up to the streetlight. To my right, the road branches off, leading to where I was heading, while directly ahead, the road was two lanes wide to my left. And a man was just coming to this intersection. Because I was being observant, I noticed right away he stopped. Just a hesitation of a second, but his body seemed to gather itself, tense up, and then I saw this thing. I don't believe it was his aura I was seeing, but rather something attached to him. I was definitely seeing it with my third eye. He had this thing attached to him. It was writhing and snaking around his body, a separate thing alive, and it was jet black. When it coiled around his face and head, it literally obscured his face. I wasn't sure what I was seeing, but it looked like bad news to me. A person's aura is usually, but not always, transparent. I've seen some that are so brilliant, you couldn't make out the features of the face, for instance, like when I saw Sorath. But never one like this. It looked bad. As soon as I saw it, the hairs on my head wanted to stand straight up, and so without hesitation, I did as my gut demanded I do, which was stand on the pedals and start pumping for all I was worth. I veered left into the farthest lanes away from him. As soon as I made a break for it, he dropped his pretense and ran right out into the road after me. He ran behind my bike, clawing at me. His fingers felt like talons sliding down the back of my coat, trying to pull me off my bike. But I had just enough of a lead that he couldn't quite get a grip, and so I pulled away down the road and escaped. Now, if I'd been oblivious and in sleepwalking mode, I'd have met him right on the sidewalk, walked right into his arms. And even when I was on the road, if I hadn't decided whatever that thing was attached to him, I wanted no part of it, listened to my intuition and taken off, he'd have had me. As I've stated elsewhere, sometimes this practice can literally save your life. Conscious awareness meditation has yet another extremely beneficial effect. It constitutes a vital aspect of psychic self-defense, as we shall examine in part 3. High Priestess Soul Lucky Star, Truth for Satan Ministries. My wisdom is not separate from my heart. Satan.